13 or 14 shows into the Incorruptible World Tour. So it's very early to tell. A classic record gets decided, you know, a few years after its release. So and the fans decide that, not me. But I think I have a pretty good feeling it will be. And the response is very strong. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The fan base is fired up. They're really accepting the set list that we've come up with, which has a lot of new songs, but a good amount of the old material as well, focusing in on a few key periods. I expect some really cool things to be happening in the States. So that's where I think we're going to see the biggest difference, because we haven't played there in like 4 years. The nightmare unfolds before my eyes. I will resist till the end of time. A spirit born free has to break these chains. We're lost, we must find our way. Well, we're talking about it, and it just depends on really if it's going to be worth the time for us to do it. I mean, it's a lot of work to do. It would be completely different than Days of Purgatory, because the only thing that was re-recorded vocals. I mean, this, we're talking about a ground-up production doing it so that we have it for a set of masters that we actually own and can exploit in our way in the future, and that this band will be able to benefit from financially going forward, because our contracts were terrible back in the old days, so there's very little income from all of the years of work. Plus, I mean, with my knowledge of production now compared to the very beginning, we can make those records sound amazing. I'm certain of that. But it's not to try to beat them. It's just to create something that we can actually control and have some financial benefit from, instead of a big corporation like Sony, you know? And people go, well, you should just focus on new music. Well, we will do that too. I have my own studio. There's no and we're not in a hurry to do a new record. We just put one out. So if we can take a year and just take the time to spend time in the studio and doing re-records and then work on a new album and then do more re-records or whatever, we can do whatever the fuck we want. You know, I don't really care if somebody lost their virginity listening to I Died For You. It's my fucking song. I'll re-record it if I want to re-record it. That's the way it is. Good music just speaks to people, and it's, you know, I mean, Maiden is multi-generational, and Black Sabbath is, and all of these really awesome metal bands, they have a lot of different age groups in their audience, you know. One of the things that I see here in Greece, for instance, is that, you know, you've got older brothers and fathers that have turned on younger brothers and sons, and that's a killer, you know, because you can see it. And I mean, I've seen it on this tour, you know, this 2018 is 30 years of Iced Earth, you know, I changed the name from Purgatory to Iced Earth in 1988. And so, I mean, there were faces in the crowd in Germany that I've been seeing for, you know, since the first album in 1990. And it's crazy, man, you know, that they're coming and they bring their sons, and it's, you know, I guess it's just something that when the music strikes a chord with people and they're passionate, then they share that passion with others and it carries on. you know, there was not a demand for Iced Earth to be on the road. You know, people that you get people make these comments, they don't know what the fuck they're talking about. See, I do, because I've been there the whole time steering the ship. And we were not in a position to, when back on an album cycle, you would basically do a European tour, and that was it for us back in our circle. We didn't have management, we weren't on a powerful record company. So that was kind of our options, and thank God for Blind Guardian, because they took us on both of those first two tours. But it started in the Burnt Offerings thing was kind of a disaster, actually. We only did like five shows in Europe, four or five shows on that album cycle, and it was a wreck. And I came back and fired some people, and we started again, and then Dark Saga was a really strong shot in the arm. But even then, we didn't start making things happen in the States until the end of the Dark Saga cycle and Days of Purgatory, and that was very small. So there was not promoters all over the world saying, "Hey, Iced Earth, we want you to tour." It was the opposite. We were desperately trying to get tours. I moved the band from Florida to Indiana to be able to go to like Cleveland, Chicago, Detroit on the weekends every now and then to try to spread it to the coasts of the United States, which worked. We did two or three van tours, then we moved into a camper, and then after that we were in a tour bus. So my strategy worked. This is purely about understanding the situation and fighting all the time and trying to push forward. That's the only thing that's kept this band going forward, believe me. So now the band can play in Russia and Israel and China and Central America and South America and North America and Eastern Europe and all over the fucking place. You know what I mean? We can go everywhere in the world. But that didn't happen like that. That took, you know, 25 years of work beforehand, laying the groundwork to make it happen. So anybody who spouts off at the mouth, "Well, we should have been, you know, doing this at whatever point," they don't know what they're talking about, because there simply wasn't offers to do it. You know, it's just the way it is, man. I mean, I was always waiting around hoping that Iron Maiden would say, "Hey, let's take Iced Earth out." Of course, you know what I mean? Everybody wants that, but that's fantasy land, man. And you can't just, you know, imagine that a market's going to work and the people are going to want to book headline shows. It's so far removed from reality. It's just silly. From the horn we hear destiny calling. Marching to the gates we see now. Seeking revenge, the heathen army. They'll bring the empire to its knees. The pagans strike, the Saxons fall. Dark Genesis, I mean, what can I say about it? It's really just a filler release Century Media wanted to do. I don't even remember what year this came out. That would have been, I guess, around the horror show period. So things were starting to get more known in America too. And I think this is just a way to package the old stuff to try to get the newer fans that come on board a cool package to buy to be able to learn about the back catalog. And it was a cool package. I mean, I haven't seen it in years, but from my memory, it was, it's coming back to me here. Oh yeah, that's killer, man. I remember that. That was our stage tricks with Blind Guardian right there. The shaving cream all over Gene. Crazy days, man. What do we have here? Aha! That's cool, man. Yeah, Kiss Alive is definitely, I would say, is responsible for me pursuing this way of life. I mean, it was certainly this record, and then what pushed it over the top was seeing the band live in 1979, and that's when I decided that's what I was going to do. But this was the first record I bought. I bought the day it was released, whenever, I think it was sometime September in 1975-ish, something like that, my sister had the first three Kiss records, so I was already familiar with their music and we were listening to it, but I really wanted to impress her and her friends because they were older than me by being the first one to get Kiss Alive, so I got it. I convinced my stepdad to take me to the record store the day it was released, and I got it, and so it was cool, and it's just, whether it's live or not doesn't even matter because it's fucking awesome. It's just got the right vibe and it's perfect illusion, man. Sons of Liberty. Yeah, it's kind of a solo record of mine that really, people always ask me if there's going to be more, and there will be. I did a 5-song EP after this, but it was only available digitally, so I never did any physical copies of it. I'm thinking about, I do have these masters back, so when I release it again in the future, I want to do a vinyl version, and I want to put the Spirit of the Times EP on there, and maybe 2 or 3 new tracks, and probably do a double vinyl with some cool artwork and stuff. But next on my agenda is the Demons of Wizard stuff. And that's this year that I'm focusing on. Hansi and I've already got 3 songs going, but this year, I would really love to get my parts finished. So that's and if you have the master tracking done, we'll see. Number of the Beast. First of all, cassettes. That's interesting that you're bringing cassettes. That's pretty cool. It's funny how these are starting to get kind of trendy again, with young people. I don't think they sound good. I've never been a fan of cassettes because if you play them, 20, 30 times, they start to degrade in sound quality. But there is something very nostalgic and cool about having them. And I didn't even talk about Number of the Beast. Number of the Beast, come on. What are you talking about? What can you say? Greatest heavy metal album ever. Right there. Enough said. Highway to Hell. Man, that guy is missed. I can tell you that. One of the best rhythm players and definitely the secret weapon of AC/DC. So it was a very sad day. This album rules, man. I mean, what can you say about it? It's just a classic. There's every song fucking rules. There is not a bad track on this album. The Bon Scott era is definitely my favorite, but I do love Back in Black and For Those About to Rock too. But this and everything before it is pure gold to me. It's just incredible stuff. So I mean, of course, Bon Scott is missed, but the most recent loss is Malcolm, and yeah, it's just terrible tragedy, man. He was a personal hero of mine, so.